When writing code, it is often useful to delay execution for a specific amount of time. For example, this is the code that initializes the DDR. It calls sleep to delay execution for a certain amount of nanoseconds. But remember, this is a computer we're building from scratch. So how does that even work? Measuring time is very easy. All you need is a clock. Luckily, we have a clock. In fact, a clock is one of the very first things we introduced into our design. Of course, this clock is a simple 1 and 0 alternating at a constant rate, so aside from the mere passage of time, it doesn't really tell us very much at all. So the very first thing we want is a simple circuit that just tells us how many times the clock switched from 0 to 1. That, combined with knowing the clock's frequency, tells us how much time has passed. So we can just keep a register that counts how many cycles the computer saw since the very beginning. Since our RISC-V CPU is 32 bits, we'll make the register 32 bits. The resulting C++ code is very simple. Get the start time counter, calculate how many cycles we need to wait, and now read the counter again and again and again until it reaches the destination value. Except this code doesn't work. The CPU isn't nearly efficient enough to reliably hit the destination cycle count precisely. That at least is easily fixed. Just change the condition from equality to greater or equal. Done. This code works. At least it usually works. Here's the problem. 32-bit can count from 0 to 4,294,967,295. Once that number is reached, the bits all zero out and we begin counting anew. If the sleep's beginning is before the wraparound and the sleep's end is supposed to be after the wraparound, our condition will seem to be satisfied before we even begin. You might be tempted to just check for this condition before we start. If current time plus delay is less than current time, change the condition in some way. This is a bad idea. It is entirely possible that both start count and end count are before the wraparound, but the point at which we get around to checking the counter is after it, which will effectively result in an infinite loop. How common is this problem? Our clock runs at 100 MHz. If we can only count to a little over 4 billion, we'll wrap around every 40 seconds or so. That's too frequent for us to just ignore the problem. I mean, call me optimistic, but I believe at least some users will want to run the system for longer than 42 seconds. But that problem is easy to solve, right? Instead of counting in a 32-bit register, let's count in a 64-bit register. So instead of 40 seconds between wraparounds, we now have 184 billion seconds, aka 3 billion minutes, aka 51 million hours, aka 2 million days, aka 5,000 years, aka long enough. I mean, call me pessimistic, but I don't think any user will want to run the system for longer than 5,000 years. Fixing the software to work in 64-bit is actually quite easy. Since we're working in C++, we don't really care that the CPU doesn't support 64-bit. The compiler knows how to emulate the missing functionality. All we need to do is change the types to 64-bit and we're done. Simple. Okay, not really. Here's the problem. Since the CPU is 32-bit, reading 64-bit from memory needs two operations, one to read the least significant word and one the most significant word. The problem is that those two reads happen in two different cycles, and therefore read different values. It's not typically a problem, but once every 40 seconds or so, the most significant word changes. Just like in the wraparound example at the beginning of this video, if we read the value in the middle of this change, we're going to get the wrong value. Is it a likely scenario? Probably not. The window for this problem is very, very, very small. So we might be tempted to ignore the problem outright, and you know what? It will almost always work. But I don't want almost always. I want the design to last. Maybe not 5,000 years last, but still. Actually, there is a software solution to this problem. We can read the most significant word, then the least significant, and then the most significant again. If the two reads of the most significant words are the same, we're golden. If they're different, read the least significant again and use the last read values. Assuming we can reliably complete the sequence in under 40 seconds, we should be good to go. And this procedure works, but it's neither elegant nor does it make sense to use it. We're spending a lot of cycles on preventing a situation that will practically never happen. If we're willing to spend just a bit of extra logic on this problem, we can solve it completely. Here's how the solution works. The low and high parts are not treated equally. Reading the low value returns the low part of the current cycle counter, but reading the high value returns a stored snapshot of the high part. Reading a dedicated register latches the high value to be read at a later date. Here's the fun part. The register that latches the high value for later reads is the same register that returns the low value. So all we need in order to get the correct value is to make sure we read the low value before reading the high value. Which is not as simple as it sounds. Just writing the code in this order, for example, is not guaranteed to maintain the access order. The compiler may choose to reverse the access order. It is unlikely to happen in this particular case, but like I said, built to last. One misguided solution is to mark the memory access as volatile. This is a misunderstanding of what volatile does. We do, in fact, mark the memory as volatile. Had we not done that, the compiler might have made the normally quite reasonable assumption that since we don't change the memory between reading it, then it obviously doesn't change. Under that assumption, it might turn our test loop into a single read and then an if that either returns immediately or goes into an unconditional infinite loop. The problem with volatile is that it doesn't turn off the optimizer at large. It only maintains order and access count to one specific memory location compared to itself. The compiler is still free to reorder accesses to different memory locations. But in this case, we need the optimizer to keep the loads from memory in order. We want to draw an imaginary line in the code that is a barrier between the memory reads that appear in the code before that line and those that appear after it. Luckily, we have such a construct. It's called a fence, or just barrier. I'll just give a couple of side notes. First, there are different types of barriers. This one, a read-read fence, is actually not necessarily the simplest one. There are also read-write fences, as well as write-read and write-write fences. The second point is that the compiler is not the only one who might end up mixing the order of memory accesses around. Most modern CPUs might also do this optimization. As such, many fences also produce opcodes that effectively force the CPU not to do those. This depends on the architecture. For example, the Intel lines of CPUs never reorder a load to happen before a preceding store, so a write-read fence need only affect the compiler, not the machine code. Of course, we've synthesized the simplest CPU we could get away with, and it never reorders anything. All of our fences need only be compiler barriers. With that, we're almost done. There's just one last optimization to do. During the execution of the delay loop, the system is semantically idle. Of course, it is not actually idle. The CPU is constantly executing code, switching states, and drawing power. Some architectures have a special command. On the x86 platform, it is called halt, spelled HLT because Intel, that stops the CPU's operation until it needs to continue. Sadly, the RISC-V platform does not have such a command. Which doesn't mean such a command is impossible. We just need to implement it as I/O. So we add a 64-bit register to which we write the cutoff number, the cycle count at which we want to wake up. We then implement a halt register that freezes execution until the counter is reached. Which brings up the obvious question. How? How do we freeze the execution? This actually turned out to be rather simple. If you recall the video about how the bus works, each read request gets acknowledged, and then the CPU waits for the response to become valid. We set it up so that reading the halt register makes a reply available only once the cycle counter passes the wait counter. Until that happens, the CPU doesn't switch state, doesn't execute commands, and draws significantly less power. Better yet, the system now knows the CPU is idle, and once we start to collect statistics, we can account for this time accordingly. So that's it. After the demoralizing 2 months of trying to get the stock DDR controllers to work, it's nice to have a task that gets done in 3 evenings of work. With that, I can get back to implementing my own DDR controller. Until next time, wish me luck. And thank you for watching.